Tonight we're going to continue in the Gospel of John. This will be the 49th exposition of this book. We'll be in the fourth chapter, verses 28 through 30. Now, as you recall, Jesus has been speaking to a woman at the well of Samaria, a woman that apparently wasn't the paragon of virtue. The fact that she met Jesus might appear as though it was coincidental. At least that's the way it appeared to her, but there are no coincidences with God. The meeting she had, there was a sense in which it was confrontational, and it could have been intimidating, but it wasn't. I mean, the average person couldn't have held up under this kind of dialogue. But God was in this, see? Jesus had told her some very personal things about herself, about her religion, about her fathers of her religion. And she was just been wrong on about every point that they talked about. He told her, and he didn't explain to her at all what it was. He didn't explain to her what he meant. He said he had water that if she would take it, if she would receive the water he had, she'd never thirst for it or look for another supply, in other words, of it. And he didn't explain to her what he meant. Interesting, isn't it? And the fact that the water he talked about was beyond the scope of her experience, beyond the scope of her understanding. But Jesus speaks about things that aren't.
Yes.
So that it'll intrigue the person to want to look into it a bit more.
Amen.
But when he talked to her, she didn't scoff at him.
Mm-hmm.
See, when one time when Jesus told a multitude of people, the people that he fed with five loaves and two fishes, those people, he told them that if they didn't eat his flesh and drink his blood, they had no life in them. And they scoffed, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? They scoffed at the idea. And another time when he told some people, well, you can't hear what I'm saying because you don't have ears, you don't hear my speech.
Mm-hmm.
And they scoffed. They said, we know you're that Samaritan and you've got a demon.
Mm-hmm.
See this? But this woman didn't respond that way to him. See, these other people weren't being drawn to Jesus. This woman was.
Yeah,
that's what you got to see behind the scenes, what's going on here. She was being drawn to Jesus. She was being called in a sense that not everybody is called. See, I understand there's a sense in which everybody is called. I understand, but that's not the only sense there is. Paul told the Corinthians, note, he says, that not many wise men, not many mighty men, not many rich men are called.
Yes,
see?
That's right.
There's a call that is not issued to everybody.
Yes.
They that follow Jesus are referred to as the called, the chosen, and the faithful.
Yes.
Revelation 7:14. So we're witnessing an effective call. God called this woman with the call that's effective.
Yeah.
I've mentioned this before, and you've probably heard it many times, that if you've ever been around chickens, a lot of chickens, so they have a lot of little chicks. In the yard, the little chicks are walking all over the place, wandering around, but if there's some kind of danger or something, this hen, she's got a special cluck. That all these little chicks, they know, and they all gravitate to their mother. So this is a special cluck, you might say. Well, there's a call, it's a special call.
Yes.
That when a person hears it, they come.
Yes. Amen.
Now, this is written to account for why you came to Christ, I'm talking about.
Yes.
Why you came to him. That's why you did. Because he called you, said, come to me, come. So we're witnessing an effective call here and its marvelous power. Now, it's important that our understanding be lifted out of what the world calls pragmatic, out of that. When you're talking about the works of God, you got to get out of the realm of philosophy and psychiatry and motivation and all these things that are pure wisdom of men. That's all they are. And you've got to get out of that. We want people not merely to be exposed to the words of God, but to react to them.
Yes.
You can't make that happen. Mm-hmm. If you've ever tried, you already know that.
Yeah.
You can't make that happen. So the purpose is to get close enough to God so he can direct you where to go and who to speak to and what, you know. That's the purpose. And you can't hold a class to teach people how to do that. At the first, when you come to Christ, at the first, you'll not be able to explain it. But one of the grand purposes of apostolic doctrine, in the words of Jesus, is to identify what has happened to you.
Yeah, amen.
That's one of the great purposes. And you'll notice the apostles, mostly Paul, will say, you are. Mm-hmm. Did he tell? You have been. You know, and he'd tell them what happened to him because you could not figure this out.
Yeah.
You could not know this on your own. And the reason why a lot of people doubt and all this is they don't know these things, see? And unfortunately, it's not common to hear them. And people who don't know them will read over them in Scripture. They'll just read right over them, and years later, it kind of dawn on you.
Yeah.
That's what these things are written for. They're written to help you to identify what's really happened to you in Christ, because until you can do that, it'd be very hard to live for Christ.
Yeah.
See, it'd be very hard to live for Christ if you don't know what's happened to you and why it's happened to you. But when you know, see, you yield because you're confident. You have confidence, see, than an assurance. The worst, yes.
I remember when I followed you to a few assemblies in Oklahoma and some in Kansas and watched you preach when you first come down here, and I watched it. I can testify. You started telling the people what they were in Christ, and their heads would come up.
Yeah, I know.
It's like they never made this connection, but see, it had to be preached. But as it was preached, they got it. I mean, they got some of it. I don't know how much they got, but they got enough that you could tell. You could tell they were interested in that.
Yeah, if you've got the real thing, when you hear about it, you'll eventually recognize it. I understand it may take a little while for it to seep in, but when it finally does it, it makes a dramatic difference in the way you live. You live with your head up, so to speak. So to speak. All right, here's our text. John 4:28-30. The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city, and saith to the men, come, see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came to him. Well, you see short sentences, but there's a lot there.
Amen. Yeah.
Then the woman left. Well, she came out there with a water pot to get some water. She left her water pot.
Yeah.
Went back into the city. So how do you explain people acting on what Jesus said? Why do they change what they're doing? Why? Why do they speak like they do? Why? Why do they witness to others? Why do they do this? Those who walk by faith, who walk in the flesh, they can't answer these questions. They can just kind of speculate and philosophize about it. That's why certain people teach others how to witness.
Yeah, that's right.
Uh-huh. Teach them how to witness, how to share their faith. There's whole seminars on this subject to teach people how to share their faith. See, they're just one big fat waste of time. God will not work through human programs. And people who say they do, say he will, have just been deceived. He doesn't. That's the way it is. If man's the originator of it, the power of God will not come into it. They'll have to use coercion or some form of reasoning, but it won't, they won't do what God desires to do. Even when Jesus told people not to say anything, they did. Don't tell anybody, then they go tell everybody. The only exception to that is when Jesus, when they said, when Peter, James, and John saw Jesus transfigured, what an experience that was, huh? Came down, Jesus said, don't tell anybody about this till I've risen from the dead. And they didn't even know what risen from the dead means. See? Don't tell anybody. But when he'd tell other people, they'd publish it all. They just couldn't keep quiet. Well, there were times when, like the Gadarene demoniac, when he was healed, Jesus said, the man wanted to go with Jesus. Jesus get in a boat to go back because he just came over there to just heal that man. And he heading back, and the man came, wanted to go with him. And he said, no, you stay here. This is a place occupied by Satan, remember? It's a place where demons felt at home. They didn't want to leave this area. These demons didn't want to leave this area. He said, you stay here, go home to thy friends and tell them what great things the Lord hath done unto thee and how he had compassion on you. There's sometimes he'd say things like that. Yeah. And the man did, of course. I want to know more of a compelling Jesus. I've had my share of an intellectual Jesus, a traditional Jesus, a religious Jesus. I mean, I've been exposed to all that myself. I don't criticize the people who they were trying to do right, but it didn't. I want a motivating Jesus. See, Paul put it in words. That's what I like about the scripture. He put it in words. The love of Christ constraineth us, compels us, because we thus judge, if one died for all, then all died, that they which live should not henceforth from on live unto themselves, but unto him who died for them and rose again. That's why Jesus died. Yes. Jesus died so people would stop living for themselves. Unto themselves. That is, they themselves won't be the objective of what they do. Now see, that's what you want. You want a compelling Christ. And when you love Christ, it makes you do what other people try to get people to do. But they can't get it done. That's why. Because God only works with what he's ordained. He does not work with anything he's not ordained. Well, she left her water pot. She'd come to Jacob's well to draw water. I assume it was because she needed water. But she left it. Something happened that made her forget about that.
That's right.
Water pot. Her focus was adjusted, different. Yeah. It was changed. Her focus was changed. What she thought about was changed. Just one confrontation. This is just one confrontation with Jesus. This is just one change.
Amen.
She forgot what she thought was very necessary at the first. Her priorities were all adjusted. Now, it's possible that a person can experience this and not know what's happened. They kind of sense their priorities have been changed, but they don't really understand it. And there are people that will try and talk you out of that. Say, well, you know, this will all pass. You know, we remember that way once too. But you'll be like the rest of us if you just stick around a while; it'll wear off. You know. Yeah, I was told that when I was young. You know, come back from. We used to have camps that where they really did teach you about Christ. We'd come back all fired up with kids, you know, and it's just, yeah, we used to be that way too, but it'll all wear off, you know. But I'm interested in something that doesn't wear off.
Amen.
Now let's see, what kind of dialogue did she have? It wasn't like an extensive discourse. Here's what Jesus said. I'll tell you the things Jesus said to her that made her leave her water pot and go back, you know. He said, give me to drink. That's one thing he said. Then he said, if thou knowest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Now notice that he's saying, he doesn't explain. When the woman observed that Jesus had nothing to draw with, he said, and she said, are you greater than Jacob? He said, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up to everlasting life. He told her, go, call thy husband and come hither. When the woman said she didn't have a husband, Jesus responded, thou hast well said, I have no husband. Thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou hast is not thy husband. In this saidst thou truly. When the woman observed he was a prophet and asked about the proper place to worship, Jesus said, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation's of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. When the woman said she knew that the Messiah was coming, who is Christ, he said, I that speak unto thee am he. All right, that's 201 English words. You could speak them all in considerably less than 2 minutes. That's all. That's all. That's all, but look what this did.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, I account for that in the fact that the words Jesus spoke, he said, are spirit and they are life.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah,
amen. Yep.
They enliven, they make people live.
Yes.
They awaken people, they stir people.
Amen.
Not many words,
yeah.
But it's not how many words, it's who said them.
Yeah, amen.
Who spoke them? And ask you from a human standpoint, were these words enough, you think, to motivate her to do what she did just to, on an intellectual basis? I suggest to you that not only were these words spirit and life, but God was a drawing.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He was drawing this woman.
Okay.
He was calling to her. The words Jesus spoke were used by God. See, they were truthful words, so God used those words, and he opened them up to her in a way that couldn't intellectually be opened up to her. See, there's an understanding of God's word that is not intellectual. It doesn't mean it's not intelligent. It doesn't mean that, but it's more intuitive than it is intellectual.
Yes. Yeah, it is as though the things that this woman had been pondering because God was drawing her,
yes,
these things were the answer.
That's right.
They perfectly fit with what was desiring.
Yeah. It automatically drew her away from what wasn't valid.
Yeah.
She was inclined away from it and acted accordingly. See?
Amen.
If she had somebody she went to draw water for and she told them what she did here, they would have said, what's wrong? You know, what? We needed water. That's why you went out there to get water. But all of a sudden, her priorities are changed. And needing water that you could haul up in a bucket wasn't that important anymore.
Yeah.
Amen. So she kept Jesus' words. You remember Jesus said, if a man hear my words and keep them.
Yeah.
That's what she did. She retained them. She put them in her memory bank and thought on them. She kept. For a long time, I thought, keep the commandments, men obey them. But that's not, you keep them so you can obey them.
Yeah.
See, because that's exactly what Deuteronomy is, what God, Moses said in Deuteronomy, that you might keep the words to do them. See,
yes,
so you retain them.
Yes.
You don't let them get away from you. You don't forget them.
Mm-hmm.
This woman had done this.
Yes.
And so what Jesus taught his disciples, she learned firsthand.
Yeah, amen.
She went her way. returned to the place she had come, without water, without her water pot, without water. See, she'd tasted a little bit of this water already.
Amen.
Already she'd tasted a little bit of this water, even though she probably couldn't have explained it that way. So if we want spiritual affectation, that is, if you want something that makes the truth work, see, that's what people have trouble with, see. They know what the God says, some of them, but to get it done, that's the challenge. They know that Jesus said, go and make disciples. It isn't happening, so they try and make it happen, see. We got to do this, you know. Well, that doesn't, that's Moses' talk. That's not Jesus' talk.
Amen.
At all. And this woman, she had a fire in her bones, see,
yes.
That couldn't be contained or restrained. Now, if you want God to work like that, which one of us doesn't, you've got to speak the words of God. He won't do this through human tradition or we're the one true church or something like that. He won't. He doesn't work that way. He works through the truth. Well, she went home to her place and she said to the men. Oh, some of them might say, well, how come she didn't say it to the women? Well, it's just the word for men, some versions say she said to the people or she said to everyone. The word translated men is anthropos, which means humanity or humankind. It's not talking about gender when it says men. Now, there are other places in Scripture where the word men or man is used. It's not speaking about gender. For instance, man shall not live by bread alone. He's not talking about gender.
Yeah.
I will make you fishers of men. That doesn't mean only men are converted.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Let your light so shine before men. See, I'm showing you this word men.
Yeah.
Death passed upon all men. Mm-hmm. Live peaceably with all men. Jesus gave gifts to men. See, so all the way through Scripture, this teaches you that speaking of humankind, mankind, offsprings of Adam. So when it says she told the men, it means she told everybody she come in contact with. She told them all.
Yeah. Amen.
I don't know if she's at the marketplace or at home, but wherever she was, she told this witness that we're going to read about. Now again, see, I asked what would motivate a person to be this aggressive. Yeah, a lot of people say, well, I can't do that. I'm not gifted to speak. Who do you think this woman was? You think she was like an orator or something?
No.
See, enough of that. We shouldn't encourage people to say that. We should encourage them to believe God that, no, listen, God can help you in this area here.
Amen.
He can make you bold as a lion. The righteous are bold as a lion, the Scripture said. See, law can't make a person speak.
Mm-hmm.
Telling people that they should testify will not provide sufficient power to do it.
Yes.
But if they get close enough to Jesus, they'll be looking for an opportunity to testify.
People talk about what they love. I mean, they just do that. If you love it, you'll tell everybody about it.
Yeah, I've heard people, but sometimes ladies are this way because most of the time they're not given an opportunity to speak very much.
Mm-hmm.
So they say they can't speak, but you get to talking about recipes and things like that, and boy, they open up. See?
Mm-hmm.
But see, I hate to say this, but the church hasn't helped women in this area.
Yeah. That's right.
Yes, I left them content to be silent partners.
Yeah.
But this woman here, this is a woman.
That's right.
And this is Jesus that's talking to her.
Yes.
So Jesus intends that anybody, woman, young person, anybody, slave, master, anybody that hears Jesus can be empowered to testify what they've learned.
Amen. Yes.
And it'll have power. It will have power. Either it'll aggravate people or it will draw people to them. So she said, there are some people, they're afraid like the parents of the blind man Jesus healed, that the religious leaders asked him, is this your son? Well, said, you better ask him. And then John says, because they feared because the chief priests had threatened they were going to kick out of the synagogue anybody that followed him. So people have this fear of man. They're afraid to speak for fear of the repercussions. I have an idea the same kind of condition existed among the Samaritans. I have an idea that ordinarily women didn't speak like this, but she was empowered to do it. She said, come see a man. Come. I got to admit, I like this come and see. I like this come and see approach. In the kingdom of God, what has truly benefited the people can benefit anyone who receives it.
Yes.
If it helped you, we're talking about things of God. If it helped you, it can help anybody.
Yeah, amen.
See, because God's no respecter of persons. He doesn't have just blessings for certain people. Yes. This isn't the way it is at all. Come and see. When two disciples of John asked Jesus, where are you staying? Mm-hmm. He said, come and see.
Yeah.
Four times on the Isle of Patmos, John was told, come and see. Four times that was said. Now this is similar to the psalmic expression, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. See, that's... It's talking about the same type of thing. And this is good to think of ways to say this in scriptural language and with power. Look, come and see. Mm-hmm. Just come to Christ and see if what we're telling you is not the truth.
Amen. That's right.
And if you've testified, said in our fellowship, this, that, and the other, mm-hmm. just say, come and see. We're not exaggerating. Come and see.
Amen.
This woman asked him to come. She had experienced something that well. He knew they would too if they just come and come and see. So that's an aspect of spiritual realities that can't be overstated. Come and see. And sometimes that'll do what ordering people won't do. Just come and see. Taste and see that the Lord is good. And she said, come and see a man that told me all things that ever I did. Now, other versions say, told me all things that I've done or everything I did. Which is, what is that? That doesn't read like that. When you read the text, it doesn't sound like Jesus told her everything that she did. But that's what she said. He told her how many husbands she had. He told her that the husband she was with wasn't her husband. He told her she didn't know what she was worshiping. Mm-hmm. And she says, he told me all things that ever I did.
Uh-huh.
See, when Jesus spoke to her, he shined the light on the entirety of her life.
Yes.
And she knew it.
Uh-huh.
Her confrontation with Jesus, she knew within herself that he knew everything about her.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what she's saying. Yeah. He doesn't say he itemized it. That wasn't what she's saying. She said she saw who he really was and that he knew everything about her. She was saying the same thing the psalmist. Now, the psalmist said the same thing. He just said it a different way. This is Psalm 139:2. O God, thou knowest my foolishness and my sins are not hid from thee. Well, God didn't spill it out. This is not what God does. He doesn't like itemize all your sins. He just convinces you that he knows them, and that does the work. See, again, he said in Psalm 139:2, thou knowest my down sitting and my uprising. Thou knowest my thoughts afar off. Psalm 139:4, he says, there is not a word in my tongue, O Lord. Thou knowest it altogether.
Yes.
Amen. So she's saying that in her own words. That's what she's saying. Mm-hmm. This experience is confirmed by apostolic doctrine. It says that the Hebrews 4:13, neither is there any creature creature that is not manifest in his sight. But all things are naked and open to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. See, that's what this woman saw. He told me, as she perused her life, and who knows what all she saw. She perused her life. She knew. This is the Lord showing me what's in me. You may not know what's in you. Or you may have once known it and forgot it. You may not know the downward capacities you have, or the weaknesses you have, or the liabilities you have. But if you will stick around Jesus long enough, it won't be long. You'll be saying exactly what this woman said and exactly what the psalmist said. You'll know God knows everything about me, and just knowing that motivates you to do something about it.
Amen.
That's the way the kingdom of God works. Yeah. See, we are complete in him. We really are.
Yes.
Amen.
You see how that if you approach life in Christ from an academic point of view, you have to have like lessons and tutelage and directions and outlines and procedures, things like this. But when the living word of God gets inside of you, it does what all these things try and do.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah. Amen.
Powerful, powerful constraint. So she spoke to all the people there. I gather it meant whoever she had opportunity to speak to. Yes, Brother Aaron.
This reminds me of the parable that Jesus told of the lost sheep, where the shepherd went out and found the lost sheep.
Yeah.
And that's what Jesus did here.
That's right. That's right.
From her testimony is saying, I've been found.
I've been found.
That's right.
Now, there's an approach to salvation that we find him, or we find salvation. And I think that is actually being robbed. We're injured in a very, very deep way to think that we made our way to him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
All of our coming to him is the result of him coming to
Amen.
Us.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I was thinking too along those lines. Jesus didn't announce to the whole world the things about the woman. But she knew that he knew.
Yes.
I mean, it was between the two of them, and she was changed by this.
Mm-hmm.
Some people try to use programs, and they have to say, I've done this or that, and they have to announce it to everybody. But see, that's not the way the Lord works.
Yeah.
I mean, he does expose things sometimes, but the biggest thing is he changes you from the inside out.
Yeah, she didn't spell out the things she did, but I knew that some people probably knew some things she did.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, these five or six men have probably accounted for most of her adult life for sure.
That's right.
You know,
that's right.
So the fact that he was able to know about them, that had to be a pretty good deal of her life.
That's right.
I would think.
And she reasoned from that, well, then nothing's hidden from him, because all of this was probably all secret, secret things.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I was also reminded of another woman that had a similar response when Jesus talked to her, and it was the Syrophoenician that came and asked her daughter.
Yeah.
Jesus' words can seem to be pretty harsh in response to her request. But what she said was, truth, Lord.
Truth.
That's right.
She saw that, but that didn't stop her request because she knew who she had come to.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. See, here's... I don't like to dwell on something like this, but here's one of the bad things about erroneous Christianity. It gives Jesus a bad reputation. See, in this generation, Jesus has a bad reputation. What Jesus really does has pretty well been hidden from the people. And people that talk about it, it's just too general. They don't say things like Jesus said here. I have water, you know, you drink it. That isn't what's being said. And so if you let your light shine, has to do with you projecting a proper image of Christ to the people, and God will take it from there. God will take it from there.
Amen.
If you will testify to truth about Jesus, the thing that makes it effective isn't that you said it, it's that God worked with it.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, everything Jesus said was like that.
Yeah.
See, everything he said was like that. The words I speak, it doesn't make any difference what they are, their spirit in their life.
Yeah.
God will use them.
Amen.
That's how God is.
Yeah.
So we are complete in Christ.
Yes.
So the text says, is not this the Christ? He said, is not this the Christ? Mm. Now, some of the other versions, here's how they read. Could this be the Christ? That's a New King James Version. This is not the Christ, is it? It's a New American Standard Bible. New Revised Standard Version. He cannot be the Christ, can he? Basic Bible English. Is it possible that this is the Christ? Darby had it right. Is not he the Christ? Surely he can't be the Messiah, the Anointed One. That's the Amplified Bible. New Living Translation says, could he possibly be the Messiah? I object to these representations and to the ones that gave them. She didn't go back home to validate whether Jesus was Christ or not. He told her he was Christ. He says, I am he. So she knew who he was. She wanted them to know who he was. So these are total misrepresentations of what was going on here. She was saying, come and see. You'll find what I'm saying will be confirmed by your own experience if you'll just go and listen to it. So I don't care for the tone of those versions. See, they leave you like you're not intended to be left. But when you read this record, you're not to be left with some kind of question about this woman. That's not why it was written. She knew if they came and saw, they'd believe too. And that is, we're going to find it later, that it is exactly what happened. They came and heard him, and they did. They believed. It's profitable for you to ponder this in your own mind and thinking about how extensively God will work if someone will just tell the truth about Christ.
Amen.
No froth.
Amen.
No personal interpretation. Just lay out what it really is and what he really has to give, just like he said. Say it like he said it. It's staggering to consider what God can do if someone will just repeat the record he's given of his son. You may say, well, people are not going to know what we mean if we say he has water. She didn't know either.
That's right.
He didn't explain this to her. But God worked with, see, that's what you bank on. God working with the word that you have to open it up.
Thinking about the parable of the treasure hidden in a field too, because this woman had that kind of reaction.
That's right.
Instead of that man that, to which when he found for joy thereof, went and sold all that he
had.
That's
right.
Now that's what a man values, is what he has. And so his whole value system changed in a moment of time.
That's right.
Because the treasure had a, it had a value to it that was greater than the value of what he had.
That's right.
And that's the manner of the kingdom.
Yeah.
The kingdom is the treasure.
Yeah.
That's what the treasure is. And it has transcendent value to anything that this earth can offer.
Yeah.
The things that Jesus offered her, you can't get anywhere in the world.
That's right.
The water that is living, that you don't have to get again. Presumed in this is the idea of forgiveness, because from one point he's exposing her sin, from another viewpoint he says he's going to give her the water. And so you see that's also involved in this. And then the fact that he knows everything about her. See, these are all things that are transcendent to anything in the world. And so if we're going to have a message for the world, and if we expect for them to leave the world, we're going to have to offer them something that the world doesn't have.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes.
And there's something about Jesus' words. When you use his words, they draw.
Yeah.
Like you said, the woman didn't know about this water, but it resonated with her. And we've all experienced this when we hear something about Christ. It's like it draws you to him.
Amen.
Yes.
We know that this woman had been looking because she said, we know that Messiah is coming, which is Christ. So she'd been digging.
Paul was banking on this too. He had practiced this. When he's talking about the Lord's table, he said, I'm going to give you what the Lord gave me.
Yeah.
And then he just told us.
Yeah.
And all through his epistles, he said, I don't speak words of man's wisdom.
Yeah.
He was counting, he was banking on Christ's words to be effective.
That's right. Amen.
You know, earlier Brother Given in the account, she said that we know when the Christ comes, he'll tell us all things. So she's going back town and saying, I found that man.
Yeah,
he's going to tell us all things.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's good.
So when they heard the testimony, they must have known of her to some extent.
Mm-hmm.
And the change in her must have been very noticeable.
Yeah.
I don't know how she was before, and she's, if someone ever confronted her about living with someone, wasn't her husband or not, but I don't know. But I have an idea if they did, it was confrontational to argue back or something like that. But they could tell something's happened to this woman.
Yeah.
Yes, June.
She had the knowledge that Messiah would come. When she said that to them, surely they had that same.
Yeah.
That's
so
good.
They wanted to see that they didn't discount that.
Mm-hmm.
If it was possible that he had
come,
they wanted to go and see.
That's right.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
And they've been digging too.
So they went out of the city and came to him.
Uh-huh.
This is the city of Samaria. This is the first time this city comes into the ministry of Jesus. This is the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was incidental. He was on his way from Judea to Galilee, and he must needs pass through Samaria.
Uh-huh.
So this was not like a normal place you would find Jesus,
mm-hmm.
not in Samaria. These people had to leave Samaria to go to Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's right.
See, from the highest perspective, Jesus went there to gather some sheep that were not of the fold.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Other sheep that are not of this fold.
Yes.
John 10:16. So he went there to pick up some sheep that didn't belong to the Jewish fold.
Uh-huh.
But they did belong in his fold.
Amen.
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 When he came to the city, remember, it said from an hour before, he was wearied with his journey, and he sat on the well.
Mm.
But see, there was a higher.
Yeah.
There was a higher. It's like the Father said, stop here. We've got some sheep. We've got some sheep to gather here.
Mm-hmm.
Stop here. Ended up, he didn't sound weary. These people came and he preached to them and everything. See, it didn't look like he was weary.
Yeah.
He'd been revitalized.
Mm.
Now, everybody that came to Jesus, they had to leave someplace
mm-hmm.
to come to Jesus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, the Gospels tell us some places people left to come to Jesus. Luke 5:17 said they left every town in Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem.
Mm.
How's that?
Yeah.
Mm.
That'd be like saying everybody from Tulsa to Springfield.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that'd be like saying.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Another text in Luke 6:17, from the sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, that whole area.
Mm-hmm.
They left that to come to Jesus. Matthew 4:25 says from Decapolis and from beyond Jordan. Yeah, beyond the east side of Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
From every quarter, Mark 1:45 says. And then the people from Capernaum all filled up a house in Mark 2:1. So the point I'm bringing out is the people had to leave one place to come to Jesus.
Amen.
This was the case when with many people who heard Jesus, they had to leave where they were and come to Jesus. Now, the same principle has been integrated into the appropriation of salvation. The same thing. The people must come to Jesus.
Amen.
I know God's behind it and drawing, but they have to come.
That's right.
Jesus said, come unto me.
Yes.
You gotta come, you gotta leave something to come.
That's right.
Come unto me. Why it's necessary to follow Jesus. I've listened to some texts where he mentions follow. You gotta once you come to Jesus, Jesus does not just stay in one place.
Yeah.
He moves about.
Mm-hmm.
Once you come to Jesus, you gotta follow.
Amen.
If Jesus is taking people into deeper, he has said to an assembly, launch out into the deep.
Yeah.
See? You better be launching out.
Amen.
Don't be staying in the shallow stuff.
That's right.
I sense that kind of call has come to us. Mm-hmm. Launch out into the deep.
That's right.
Let the shoreline go, the song says.
Yeah.
That's where the slime all is, you know.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
That's what the song says, too.
Yeah.
Somebody linger up by the shore where all the slime is.
That's right.
We used to live near Lake Michigan, you know.
Yeah.
And where they didn't regularly clean the shoreline, it was all kind of dead fish and debris and weeds and all kind of stuff washed up on the shore. And beside that, when you get in shallow water, you know, there's only minnows. There's no fish of any size. If you want a good catch, you got to launch out into the deep. That means come to Jesus, because Jesus he's out and away from the world.
Yeah.
Then Jesus says, now all the Father gives me will come to me.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So this woman had been given to Jesus.
That's
the scripture, I think I've said this, but maybe I haven't. But the scripture will identify what's happened to you in Christ. You'll say, think ye are, we are. That's what it's doing. It's identifying what's happened to you. So you can understand it. What a great thing has been done.
Amen.
You've been lifted out of the miry clay. See, your feet have been set on a solid rock. See, the scriptures tell you what's happened.
Amen.
God delivered you from this present evil world. See? He recreated you. That's explaining what's happened to the people of God. And that's one of the great purposes of apostolic doctrine. That's why to neglect it means the people do not know what's happened to them. See, Jesus would tell people what was going to happen, but it was like disguised. The prophets told him what was going to happen. You're going to create a people. He's going to prepare a feast for them, but they didn't spell it out.
Mm-hmm.
But the apostles, they spelled it out. They told you what's really happened to people in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you feel different? Because you are different.
Yeah. Yeah.
Don't let anyone talk you out of it.
Yeah.
Don't let them say, "Well, you're not like us anymore." Just say, "Well, thank God."
Yeah.
Oh, they said, yeah, some people here have had that said to them, haven't they, Brother Gene? Some people have that said to you, you're not like us anymore.
Yeah.
But just say thank God, then explain to them why.
Yeah.
Give a little word of testimony to them, why. So viewed from the highest perspective, Jesus had come to gather some sheep, and they were coming to him from where they were. And this coming to him from where you are, this is a lifetime thing. It was to believers that he said, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. That was to a church of Corinth. That was said to them. Come out from among them and be ye. So this is a lifetime thing, which means there's all kind of, Satan has devices.
Yeah.
We're not ignorant of his devices, the scripture says. Satan has devices calculated to get you back into where he works more freely. See, there, there are environments in which Satan can work more freely. You got to get out of those environments as much as possible. Now, if you're locked in prison, it's God can deal with that too. But you've got to get out as much as you're able. You've got to get out of environments where Satan has the upper hand. I understand that there's a, you have to work. You may be a tax collector like Zacchaeus, you know. Jesus didn't make him leave tax collecting, but he wasn't the same kind of tax collector after he was with Jesus. See, so in your heart, you've got to leave in your heart, and sometimes that will involve a actual physical separation too, but in your heart, you've got to leave. They came to him. One place it says of Jesus, great multitudes came to him, having with them those who were that were blind, lame, blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, and cast them down at Jesus' feet, and he healed them. Boy. You see, I wish that would happen again. Hell, I do too. But this is the real Jesus that does this. A fictitious Jesus doesn't do this. Another Jesus doesn't do this. And there's no indication that the real Jesus ever stopped doing this.
That's right.
Not that I know of it, at any rate. If anyone knows, please inform us. But see, there's been another Jesus raised up that doesn't do these things. Now, there are places in foreign countries where these things are happening again. But it's only because the real Jesus was, somebody brought the real Jesus to the people. A powerful testimony is not one that relates what has happened to you. A powerful testimony is that what God said he'd do, he did in you. See, that's what has to be shown. That what God promised, I've experienced. Tell it.
Amen.
If that's happened to you, tell it. Don't suppress it. Because you'll overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of your testimony, and because you love not your life unto death. That's one of the means by which you overcome the devil. Now, I know the devil tried to hinder this woman just because of his nature. But she overcame him by the word of her testimony, see? She overcame the devil by the word of her testimony. He didn't draw her back. When she got back, she didn't go back to her man. It wasn't her husband, see? She overcame by the word of her testimony. You do this, it's quite a thing to think about. She did like Jesus said to the Gadarene, go home now, go home and tell your friends how great things the Lord has done unto you and has had compassion on you. Don't forget to point that out. How what you have is compassion.
Amen.
You receive compassion, not a reward for doing good.
Yes.
You receive compassion. Tell about it. 23 times in the scripture it's written that Jesus' disciples, his disciples came unto him, or his disciples came to him. 23 times in the Gospels this is written. That's after they initially came. They consistently relied on Jesus for understanding. If they didn't understand something, they didn't go to the scribes. They went to Jesus. Explain that parable to us. See, they came to Jesus. So this is a posture. This is the posture of a person that's in Christ. They are continually coming to Christ. And to come to Christ, now you got to leave some area.
Amen.
Things that require that you come to Christ, there'll be temptation to resolve it back here away from Christ. To try and resolve the situation while you're at a distance from Christ. That won't work. That won't work. You got to crucify that. You got to leave that and come to Christ. See, God's not honored by a humanly devised program. He won't work. Man may work for years to work up a good program, but God won't work through it. because the wisdom of the world is foolishness to him. He will not empower a plan he hasn't originated. Everybody must see that. If you want to really receive from God, you've got to go to the author and finisher of your faith.
Yes, amen.
Jesus is the author. That's good, isn't it?
Yes.
He's the author of your faith.
Yes, amen.
And he's the finisher. He'll bring it to perfection. He's the author and finisher of your faith. So doesn't it make a lot of sense that that's the one you go to?
Yeah, amen.
That gave you the faith and that's going to perfect it? So that it matures up where God wants it. You approach God that way to obtain his salvation and what I call the multifarious benefits. That's multifaceted. There's not only a lot of different benefits, it's the different kinds of benefits. And it's like a plethora, they'd say, of benefits that is you can't even imagine how many they are. You'll live all your lifetime. See, I've lived in Christ with an obvious devotion for over 60 years, with a consciously committed life. And there's never been a stage or a time when I wasn't in the learning mode. To this very night, I find that I must continually resort. He's a shelter in the time of storm.
Amen.
The shadow of a mighty rock in a weary land. See,
yeah.
So you got to leave one place to go to him.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
But what you get when you go to him is worth the forfeiture of what you left.
That's right.
That's the secret. See,
yes.
They shall be satisfied with thy goodness.
Amen.
The prophet says.
Amen.
See, that's the secret to sticking with the faith and keeping the faith. Is it brings satisfaction to your soul that cannot be obtained otherwise. So as simplistic as it may seem, Satan has devices calculated to take the glory away from Jesus and give it to someone else. But if you will make your way to Jesus and cast down imaginations and every high thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, anything that impedes you, anything that stops you, or hinders you, or slows you down from coming to Jesus, you make war, you take up arms, now you take up arms, you use the weapons of your warfare, and you cast that thing down, and when you come to Jesus, it'll be worth it all.
Amen. That's right.
You'll be satisfied, just like this woman was, and we're not done with the account yet, but it's some account, isn't it?
Yes.
And if you have anything you'd like to add, yes, Brother Jeremy.
This does go against the teaching that's being taught today where Jesus, you get this idea that Jesus is just here to make your dreams come true. And it's not that you sacrifice anything. It's just that Jesus is just going to give you everything that you ever wanted and nothing's going to ever go wrong now. Actually, we see here in this account that it says they left the city. It's like, over and over again, if you want something from Jesus, you're going to have to make some sacrifice.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's not like he's in this account here that the woman went to the city and Jesus said, hey, wait a minute, you know what, let me go with you, make this a little easier on you. And them too, they may not believe you, so I'll just go with you. That's not what happened.
Mm-hmm.
She took off, and who are they that went to see? We don't know, but it's the ones who wanted to see Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
He left the city.
Amen.
But you're going to have to make some sacrifices if you want to get something from Jesus.
Amen.
Mm. Amen. Yeah, this thing you mentioned about what Jesus told her to do, that she was told to tell him that the Lord hath had compassion on me. Now, I've never shared my testimony with someone when I told them that God took away my sins and he didn't give me what I deserved, but he had compassion, that it didn't cause an effect in the person. Now, it wasn't always received, but it always was. They had a response,
yeah.
You know, and generally it was like a tender kind of a.
Yeah.
I think they sensed they needed this compassion too. Whether they followed through, I don't know, but this is a delight. This is something you can do that is a delight to do. Yes, and you tell amen. Somebody what great things Christ has done in your life and that he's had compassion on you, you'll go home satisfied. Whether or not it's received or not, you will be satisfied with that.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Sister Jordan?
You were talking about the benefits. One benefit I've been thinking about for quite a while is the fact that the others that came, among them, no doubt, others believed. And so she didn't have to go back alone.
Yeah.
That's good.
She had brethren.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
You probably had some pretty sweet fellowship on the way back.
So whenever you share the things that God has given you, there's personal increase, but then there is a corporate increase.
That's right.
Also.
Yes. Amen.
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 All right. Oh, yes, Brother Rob.
Yes, sir. From the first time you asked why that she had left the water pot, it's clear that the things of a spiritual nature become more important to her than the things that she didn't see.
That's right.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Isn't that good?
Amen.
Yeah.
That's what's happened to all of us.
Yes.
That's right.
Amen, yeah. Brother.
See, sometimes it may not be clear to us that that's what happened.
Uh-huh.
So that's why it's important to say it, because those that's happened to will say, hey, that happened to me.
Amen. Yes.
That's right. Just to say that to each other, it's just a water pot.
Yeah,
that's
amen.
Right. Leave it.
Leave the water pot.
Amen.
That is something. In accounts like this, it's all you have to say to inform people know what you're talking about.
That's right.
Don't forget to leave the water pot.
That's right.
All right, we're ready for Sister Barb.